Hi friends, Doug Johnson here with Doug Johnson Productions in Orem, Utah. And today's video, we're going to talk about the Blackmagic Design optical fiber products. These are the products that they create for basically allowing interconnections between your switcher and your cameras in a studio or other live production environment. So they've elected to do it over fiber because fiber can go much longer distances than coax, SDI connection, for example. And in reality, for the type of distances that we're dealing with, the cables are actually cheaper than copper as well. So the products we're going to go over today are the studio converter, so ATEM studio converter, the ATEM camera converter, those go together. They also have some standalone conversion boxes. So this is the optical fiber 4K mini converter. They also have one that's 3G, not this one's 6G, and they also have one that's 3G as well. I'm also going to talk a little bit about some of the other products that I use with this. So I've got these boxes here that allow me to send 24 fiber signals over a couple of these MTP connections. So this one cable holds, sends 12 signals, so six cameras, since they're bidirectional, over a single cable. And that's been very handy as well. So I'll also wire up a camera to a camera converter so you can see how that works and discuss about how all it works along the way. So I'll give you my feedback. So the first product I want to talk about is this unit right here. This is the ATEM Studio Converter. This essentially provides conversion between fiber and SDI. Does distribution amplifier for sending a single program feed out to all the cameras. Gives you your intercom so your director can talk to your camera operators and they can talk back. It also handles audio, so audio from the camera comes back on this unit, comes back and has separate outputs on this on the back. So with that said, let's actually take a look at it. So on the front, we've got microphone input. You can either use this one or this one. These two right here are aviation style. So what they intend for you to do is to actually use aviation headsets that are available anywhere online or at airport supply shops. These tend to block out noise pretty well, which is a good thing because quite often when you're doing video production, you're in noisy environments. Also, these tend to be less expensive than some of the high-end professional headsets that are out there. But you can use those as well, as long as you adapt it with an XLR and quarter-inch connection. So next we have the push-to-talk and latch-to-talk buttons. So the top row is push-to-talk. So if you want to talk to a single camera operator, you can press and hold that button, and then that mutes the audio to all other camera operators. So you just want to talk to one by themselves, you can do that. And over here we have program audio and then a mute button. The unit does have a built-in speaker. The speaker is disabled whenever you have a headset plugged in. The speaker actually sounds fairly good for being a rack mount unit. And then a level control. And this controls both the audio level for the built-in speaker and for the headset. All right. Now flip this around and talk a little bit about the connections on the back. So starting this end, we've got our standard power connector. And there's RCA audio connections here, which provide the intercom audio. So one of the things that I do with my camera operators is I actually record the intercom audio along with a quad view. So two by two grid of three cameras plus program feed. And we go back and review that after an event so we can talk about what we did well and what we need to improve on. That's been tremendously helpful, and having the dedicated audio outputs on the studio converter has been very helpful for me. Okay, and then continuing over here, this is an SDI video output. And this is channel one, so this is the video output for camera one, and you have the fiber connection below that. So this is bidirectional again. The one on the left is output, the one on the right is input, and then we have line level audio coming from the camera on two XLR connections. So there are four of these identical, one, two, three, and four. And then over here we have our auxiliary connections. So this first row is we have a program in. So this is the video that gets sent back to camera operators so that if they want to view program instead of their own camera, they get the video from here. This is a loop output. So if you stack multiple of these units for more than four cameras, you can just continue to send that video up the chain. And then these last four here are microphone and headphone input and output. And these are AES digital signals and allow you, and connecting these between units. So if you have multiple of these, it allows you to have audio be shared across all the camera operators. And if you have a director and a technical director, for example, you can have one headset plugged into each one of these studio converters if you have multiple. And those connections are what actually allow the audio to be shared between. One thing I'm actually doing with that that's a little different is I have these AES audio connections going to a Behringer UltraMatch Pro audio converter, which converts it to analog, and then I run that into a rack mount audio mixer where I can mix it with program audio, with other audio sources. Say for example, if I have someone on graphics and I give them a headset so they can talk, that gets mixed in at that location as well. And then the analog output of that mixer goes back into the UltraMatch, which is then converted back to AES and then sent back here. So that allows me to get external audio into the intercom system. It also gives me an opportunity to have the intercom audio be sent somewhere else. So if, for example, I needed to interface with another RTS system or something similar, using the UltraMatch allows me to do that analog conversion in order to make that happen. So anyway, that's essentially the way this works. So each of these fiber connections is meant to be run to the camera converter. So I'm just going to make a connection there real quick. You just insert the cable and it clicks. And then on the other end, we've got that plugged into their camera converter product. So this is the unit that you would have at each camera. This provides connections for video input, video output, auxiliary audio, and your intercom. This uses a PC style or iPhone style headsets. So they're easy to get a hold of, inexpensive. You just plug them in here and your camera operators can hear you, hear the director and talk back as needed. So the SDI inputs on here, the SDI and HDMI input, you can use one or the other. I believe whichever one is plugged in first is the one that takes precedence. And then the SDI and HDMI outputs, those are both always active. And I'll give you a little bit closer view of that. So analog inputs here, these are quarter inch TRS. I believe they are balanced. The one thing to watch out for here is that these are microphone level, not line level like you normally find with a TRS connection. And so if you're assuming that you can just plug in a line level audio source, you're going to end up with horribly distorted audio. So make sure if you're doing that, you put a pad between your line level source and the inputs here. Plugging in audio here does override audio from the camera. If you don't have anything plugged in here, then audio from the camera is sent back on the fiber lines. Since the SDI and HDMI outputs are both always active, you can theoretically be running two monitors or sending one to a projector or something along those lines. The output of these is selected by the camera operator. It can either be their own local camera or it can be the program video feed. And that's selected on the front panel. I'm gonna flip this around here. So this first lit up button here, the program button. So pressing that button toggles between program feed and local camera. The other buttons on here are two buttons to adjust the microphone audio level, a power button, a button for assigning the unique camera ID for each camera in the system, a button for controlling headphone audio level, and then a push to talk, which you either press and hold for a brief or double press it in order to latch the audio on. On the opposite end, there are four LEDs indicating the level of the battery, more about that in a minute, and then indicators of good quality video on optical input and on the SDI or HDMI video input. So, as mentioned, these actually do have a battery in them. The battery runs for about 2 hours, thereabouts, which may be useful for some productions, but in others may not be enough. But it is nice to have if you have a roaming camera operator, and you're not going to be, you don't want to have tied down to an AC outlet. They can actually wander around. This has a belt clip on the back, so they can stick that on their belt, walk around, have somebody help with the fiber cable, so that it doesn't get twisted or stepped on or other damage to it, and then they can wander around for up to 2 hours away from AC power. So that's pretty handy. All right. So Blackmagic Design does have one other product that's similar to the Studio Converter. It's called the TalkBack Converter. Instead of offering just four channels, it actually does up to eight. However, there are some differences. So I don't have one of those to show you, but I can certainly describe the differences. So first of all, the TalkBack Converter doesn't have the audio outputs. And so if you need audio, you have to do something else in order to get that. They also have an SDI video output, so you can connect the cameras either via fiber or via SDI. So if your cameras are close enough that an SDI cable will work, you can actually use an SDI connection instead of fiber. One of the downsides to that unit is that even though it does support optical, it doesn't include these SFP modules, which convert the electrical signal to an optical signal that can go over an optical cable. So if you want to use the TalkBack Converter with fiber, you'll have to make an investment and purchase up to eight of these. Blackmagic does sell them. The 6 gig version is about $200 a piece. The 3 gig version is about $140, thereabouts. The Studio Converter does include all four of those, and these are 6 gig. So even though the website doesn't really advertise that the Studio Converter is a 4K unit, it actually is. It supports 6 gig, so it does 4K up to 30 frames per second. They do not currently offer a product which does 12 gig, so if you need to do 4K 60 frames per second, you'll be looking at another solution. Blackmagic currently doesn't have one. The downside is that this camera converter is only 3 gig SDI, so there's no 4K camera converter yet. I'm really hoping, crossing my fingers, that they'll announce a product at NAB this year that basically gives us a 4K camera converter. That would be very helpful. This is the only piece in my entire setup at this point that does not do 4K. And if I'm doing a 4K production, I do have to run separate video connections from the camera to my switcher in order to get the 4K video into the switcher rack. So, speaking of 4K, this is another conversion unit. This is what they call the Optical Fiber 4K Mini Converter. So it has SDI in, SDI out on one side, and then it has your optical connection. And this is, like I said, this is bidirectional, so you can both send and receive video with this unit. They also have a 3 gig version of this one, just called the optical fiber. It doesn't have the 4K in the name. Considerably less money. It does do true 3 gig, so you can do up to 1080p, 60 frames per second. So that about summarizes the Blackmagic optical products that I actually own. I've supplemented a lot of this because Blackmagic Design is using industry standards for types of connections and the signaling. You can actually interface with other products as well. And one of the types of things that I've done is I've invested in these fiber cassettes. So each one of these takes up to 12 duplex connections. They snap right in there. And then on the back side, they have MPO or MTP connections, which then connect to cable, looks like this. And pull the dust cap off of there. And that snaps into the back. And that way I send 12 video signals over one single cable. And this reel is actually 150 meters, so nearly 500 feet. So I can send all the video signals I need for six cameras over one single cable. It's very, very, very handy if you're setting up in an environment where the director has to be physically located away from the camera operators, or for, say, a sporting event where the venues happen to be quite large. You could send video for half your cameras on the opposite end of the field over one of these cables. I have another one of these as well, so I can actually do a total of 24 video signals, 12 each direction, 12, send 12, receive 12, over just a pair of these tiny cables. So that's very handy. It's extremely handy. So when I'm doing multi-camera productions, it's very easy to make sure that I'm not running a bazillion cables and getting in people's way. I can just run a single cable for up to six cameras. The other nice thing is that because this is an industry standard, these are also used for networking. So if I need to send Ethernet connections, say for example, my pan-tilt zoom cameras, they operate over Ethernet, I can actually use a media converter on both ends to send a gigabit Ethernet connection over fiber. And those don't have the distance limitations that is associated with copper. So normally a copper Ethernet connection, you're good for maybe up to about 400 feet. They say 100 meters. However, with fiber, you can go great distances. That also works with the Blackmagic stuff. So one of the advantages of using single mode fiber as they do is that you're able to go very long distances. They quote up to 28 miles for standard def, 17 miles for high def, and I can't remember the exact number for ultra high def, but it's numerous miles as well. So you're not dealing with the short distance limitations of SDI. An SDI cable, even a good quality cable, the signal can break down in as little as 100, 150 feet. And depending on the quality of the cable, what data rate you're using, and the environment it's being run in, you might find an SDI signal breaks down very quickly. And it's not even rated past 100 meters. And so if you need to do long cable runs, you really do need to be running fiber. So another thing that I've done is I've invested in, these are, even though, you know, single mode fiber cables are normally yellow, this one obviously is not. This is what they call a armored cable. So the cable itself is actually a little thicker than the yellow. And the reason for that is that each one of these has a metal sheath around the outside to protect it. So in case the cable gets stepped on or pinched in a doorway or whatever, it's much better protected from damage. So all the cables that I actually run to the cameras themselves, I use these armored cables for that. And just one less potential thing to go wrong. So. All right, so now that we've actually discussed what the different products are, let's actually go through making the connections at a camera. So I've got one of my cameras here. These are the cameras that I use for most things. This is the Sony PXWZ150. This is actually a 4K camera. Has pretty good zoom on it. One of the nice things about it is it does have an SDI output. So I've got an SDI output there on the back. These have great image quality, especially for the price. I really love them, and I very highly recommend them. But what I've done is for each one of the cameras that we're running, I've got a bin that has all the connections that we need. So let me pull some of these things out here. So got an HDMI cable here, and that's used for connecting up the LCD monitor. I've got a second HDMI. That was for when I was actually running a different cameras that had HDMI output, but it'll keep it in there. An SDI cable for video from the camera. There's a zoom controller. Power connection for LCD monitor. This is a bit of a mess. Last camera operator that put it away didn't do a great job of making sure that it was neat. All right, three-way splitter power cable. AC power connection for the camera converter. A headset for the camera operator. Camera converter itself, and then I have a an LCD monitor. So I'm gonna move this out of the way. So this is an LCD monitor that's actually set up on the camera. And so it has an HDMI input on it, and it actually has a built-in sunshade, which is really nice when shooting outdoors. And then a cold shoe mount. And so that slides on the shoe on the front of the camera. Before I do that though, I want to flip out the LCD. That won't flip out once that's on there. So pop that on there. And then at that point I can start making connections. So I've got the camera converter here. First connection I would make would be a fiber connection from the switcher rack. So that would get plugged in. And next we'll do the video coming from the camera. So that goes from the SDI, let me zoom in here for you. It goes from the SDI connection output on the camera to the SDI input on the camera converter. And assuming battery is actually charged. Yeah, we should see the video light come on here momentarily, indicating that it's getting good video from the camera. Yeah, there we go. So we're getting video from the camera at this point. Okay. The next connection that I would make would be an HDMI connection for the monitor on camera LCD. So I plug that into the HDMI output, and then on the back of the LCD monitor, do the HDMI input. A little hard to do from the back. There we go. Okay. And then I can start connecting up power. So plug into my power strip. And then connect the power for the camera converter. So just 12 volt connection. Now we're getting AC power, and then another adapter for the LCD monitor. And in this case, let me raise that hood up a little bit so you'll be able to see. So we're seeing a black video signal because there we go. So there we have video that's passing from the camera through the camera converter back to the LCD monitor. Now if I press the program button, I don't have an optical connection here at the moment, but if I did, that would show the program feed coming from the switcher. It switches back and forth, and depending on how long the monitor takes to resync, there might be a second or two every time you hit the button. But if you have a high quality monitor with good sync capabilities, it should switch over very quickly. But that essentially is the camera connections. And then the last connection that we make is the headset for the camera operator. And so this is just a PC style gaming headset, nothing too fancy. And it connects to the audio input and output. Headphone on the right, and then microphone on the left. And with that, all the connections are actually made. And then it's ready to go. So pretty straightforward. Several of my camera operators are actually not that tech savvy, but they're able to do this pretty easily. So that's kind of the summary of the Blackmagic optical fiber products. I'll just go over some of the pricing on those things. The studio converter, this guy right here, it's MSRP is $1,995. Street price is usually closer to about $1,900. The talkback converter, 4K, which is the 8 camera version of this that doesn't include the optical SFPs, it's $2,495 recommended price, and the street price is about $2,375. And then the SFP modules, if you get the 3 gig, they're street price about $115, and then 6 gig is about $195. And so if you're going to run eight cameras in 4K, you're looking at 8 times 195, so roughly another $1,600 on top of the price of the TalkBack converter itself. The camera converter, which works with both the TalkBack converter and the studio converter, this unit, recommended price on that's $595, street price is about $565. I'm really hoping that Blackmagic announces a 4K version of that in NAB this year, though I'm not necessarily holding my breath. The optical fiber converter, this is the 4K version. Recommended price on that's $495, street price is about $470. The 3 gig version of that recommended is $195 and street price is about $185. These products do all interoperate. So if I want to send video to or from a location where I'm not going to have a camera operator that needs communication and doesn't need an HDMI output for an LCD, I can use one of these connected up to this and it'll send audio and video and back and forth over the fiber optic cable. And again, single mode fiber that they use, what do I do with my, yeah, there we go. So, yellow jacket most of the time. Don't buy the orange stuff, that's multi-mode. That may work for short distances, but it isn't recommended. So single mode with an LC connector in blue, indicating that it's the standard or unpolished. You don't want the APC, which is angled polished. Those connectors are usually green. Make sure you're getting blue connectors on your optical cables. So, okay, wait, before we get to the conclusion here, I wanted to actually share my thoughts about some of these things. I know I presented a lot of factual information in this video, but I didn't really share much as far as opinions on what I thought about this stuff. So before we get to the final conclusion, let me go over some of that. So to start with the studio converter itself, for the most part, I've actually really liked this product. It's been pretty good. You know, it's actually done what it's supposed to do. It works well, easy to use. I am actually on my second one because my first one developed a problem where the audio in the right channel of the headphones first of all started cutting in and out, and then it went out entirely. Blackmagic was good to replace it for me. It was still under warranty. They actually overnighted one to me because I explained that I couldn't have any downtime, so they sent me a new one, no cost. That worked out really well. So no major inconvenience on that one. I do not like the way this thing handles program audio. It's just the one button on the front, right here, and pressing it is basically a toggle. So either program audio is on in the intercom or it's off. The problem with that is you can't set the level. So if your program audio is too quiet, you can't turn it up. If it's too loud, you can't turn it down. And the other issue there is when that's on, the director's mic becomes voice activated. So it's constantly cutting in and out. And most of the people that I worked with find that extremely annoying. And so we don't ever use it. I use my separate solution where I send AES audio out of this to another rack in order for processing. So I inject program audio that way. That way I have control over it. I can equalize it. I can set levels and so forth. Other than that, this unit has worked really well. The one complaint some people might have with it is the fan. See if I have a power cable here handy to plug it in so you can hear just how loud the thing is. It's not horrible. You can probably hear, you should be able to hear that on camera. So it's loud enough that it could be a problem if you're using it on set, but if you're in a live production environment where the switcher and director are away from the event that you're shooting, not an issue. I've had questions about that though, so I just wanted to make sure everybody is aware that it does have a fan and it does produce some noise. All right, moving on to the camera converter. I've actually really liked this product. This has worked quite well for me. I haven't had any major issues except for one a few weeks ago. I was doing a production that needed 6 cameras, and I have exactly enough equipment in terms of the optical in order to do 6 cameras. And one of the optical outputs failed on me. And so I couldn't get video from the camera to the switcher. If it had been the other direction, would have been something I could deal with. But obviously, if you don't have video from your camera, camera's useless. And so I was down a camera. I wasn't able to do the 6 cameras that I was supposed to. In this case, the switcher was too far away from the cameras in order to run an SDI cable. So it wasn't an option. I had to go optical when I was out of equipment. Blackmagic was good to replace it. It only took about 3 emails back and forth with one of their tech support engineers for them to give me an RMA, and then I shipped it in, and then a week and a half later,
I had a replacement. They couldn't fix it, so they sent me a replacement. The one big complaint about this, and I did mention this in the video, is they don't have a 4K version of this. So any production where I want to do 4K, I still use the camera converter for video to the camera, for intercom, for tally, but video coming from the camera, I have to run a separate SDI cable. I don't have enough of these 4K optical fiber in order to send the 4K video over fiber, but if I run SDI from the camera to the switcher separately, then I can still switch 4K, but then you're not just running an optical cable, you're also running an optical cable and an SDI cable, and of course you're limited by distance, and SDI cables tend to be a little bit more problematic to work with as you're moving around. So, but other than that, this product has worked quite well for me. No real complaints there. It'd be nice if it was a little smaller and a little lighter. I don't need the audio, so in terms of my needs, they could have omitted that and I would have been fine with it. But other than that, the product has been pretty good. It'd be nice if the battery life was a little longer, more than 2 hours. I'd like to see about four most of the events that I do. By the time you factor in setup time and the event itself, that tends to run at least 4 hours. So a longer battery life would be great there. The mini converters, the fiber optic, optical fiber 4K, and then the regular 3 gig version, no problems. They've actually worked pretty well for me. I did have one time where, I don't know whether it was a brownout on the power or what, not, but I had to unplug the power and plug it back in order to get for it to pass video. Took me a few minutes to troubleshoot, but like once I plugged it back in, it was fine. And that's only done that once in all the times I've used it, so not too awful there. And most electronics occasionally will glitch like that, so I can't fault them too much on that. So everything else, these cables have been fantastic. I have had at least a couple of these yellow cables die on me. I mean, this is glass in here, so it is delicate. So you don't want to bend it any tighter than a certain radius. And of course, if somebody steps on it, especially with like a high-heeled shoe or something like that, it can break. So you do have to be careful with them. But I'm not going to fault them for that. It's just kind of the nature of the beast. Other than that, I've been very happy for the most part with the Blackmagic Optical fiber products. They've worked pretty well for me. The one that I haven't mentioned in this video is the studio camera that they have. It does have an option for an SFP in order to go fully optical from the switcher to the camera. I have elected not to purchase that product. It does not meet my needs. The main problem being, well, two, and I'll discuss this in another video. Not very good handling of low light and poor selection of lenses, basically. Even though you use the Micro Four Thirds mount, there just aren't many appropriate Micro Four Thirds lenses out there for video. So anyway, I'll do a whole separate video about that at some point. So anyway, so those are my thoughts on the optical fiber products, and we'll return now back to the conclusion for the video. That's about it. If you do purchase any of these products, I'd appreciate you using the links down in the description below. To help support these videos. If you buy anything else, video production, here's the general link in the description as well. That really helps me out a lot and allows me to actually buy some of these products so I can review them. I don't actually get these products from the manufacturers. These are being purchased out of my own pocket. So the more support I get, the better it is. And I can provide more reviews for more products. Be sure to like and subscribe. I'm going to try and post these videos on average about once a week. There are times when I get busy and I may get behind, but I'll try and do a video about once a week. Also, let me know in the comments what you want me to talk about. So this video is actually the result of a lot of people talking to me about the optical fiber products that Blackmagic offers, because there's not a lot of information out there. Another question I seem to get daily, what am I using for my pan and tilt zoom camera, what allows me to control it with an Xbox controller. There's a link to a video also in the description as well. So with that, thanks for watching and have a great day.